Hello, hello.
Hi, everyone.
Hello.
Ah, many familiar faces. So, as everyone kind of files in digitally, I would like to welcome everyone. Thanks also for giving us a few minutes to get our bearings. It's a huge pleasure to introduce Mary Wang and Hilton Als for our first public online Zoom event at MA Curatorial Practice, at SVA's MA Curatorial Practice. My name is Brian Kwan Wood. I am Director of Research here in the department, and it's a real pleasure to finally have made this happen. So it was a real endeavor. I'm still sort of admitting people into the meeting, and we're all sort of still, I think the planet is navigating Zoom. Hopefully it will go off without any too many snags, or only the best kinds of snags. Just for a bit of introduction to the program that we have this semester, we have four other events coming up. All of them are going to be on Zoom. They are at different times. You can check the department website for MA Curatorial Practice for more information. On Thursday, October 15th, we will have Zoe Leonard in conversation with Legacy Russell on Legacy's upcoming book, Glitch Feminism. So that will be Thursday, October 15th from 11 a.m. to 12 p.m. Eastern time. All of these times are Eastern time. On Friday, October 23rd, we will have Richard Burkett in conversation with Mason Laver Yap from 11 a.m. to 12 p.m. Also on Zoom. And on Wednesday, November 4th, we'll have an event entitled Beyond the Exhibition with Nikita Yingtian Tsai and Jianru Wu from the Guangdong Times Museum in China. And that will be November 4th from 8 to 9 p.m. Eastern Time. And on Friday, December 11th, from 11 a.m. to 12 p.m., we will have an event entitled On the Politics of Friendship with Stephen Henry Madoff, the chair of the program, who has just joined us in this meeting, Celine Condorelli, Christina Newman-Scott, and Shudabrata Sengupta from Rax Media Collective. So if you want to also RSVP to any of these events, just send an email to nacp@sva.edu with the name of the event you want to RSVP to and your name, and we will get you registered. For now, I will briefly introduce Mary. I think Mary will introduce her guest, Hilton. It's really a great pleasure to have you here. Also, it should be understood that there is a kind of like a nested event within this event, within the event, right? Which is that this is the first live edition of writer and editor Mary Wang's Miscellaneous Files, which is a series of virtual studio visits.
I love that title.
Sorry?
I love that title.
Yeah. Miscellaneous Files. It's a set of virtual studio visits that she does on Guernica magazine, which uses, very important, uses screenshots from writers' digital devices to understand their practice. So this will be also a very visual heavy conversation. And this being its inaugural live edition, Mary will speak with Hilton Als to present a selection of visual fragments that have shaped his work. And now it's my great pleasure to turn the Zoom over to Mary.
Thank you.
I should mention also that by way of time and some formalities, right? These are very important in this world. So we may go a little bit over time. I think Mary and Hilton would like to go for about 50 minutes and then we can take Q&A. Please, as you saw in my notes to all of you, keep your mics on mute. And when we're ready for questions, when you are prompted by Hilton and Mary, please ask your questions using the chat feature in Zoom. Okay? Great, sorry.
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you for inviting me. As I've said many times to you, I'm a Zoom dummy. So thank you for having a Zoom dummy set off your series of Zoom events. And I would also like to thank Guernica for providing the space for me to conduct an experiment like this, a visual experiment with usually textual writers. So Guernica is supported by the donations of their readers. So if you have a minute, please feel free to go to www.guernicamag.com where you can find stories on art and politics around the globe. And here we have Hilton. It feels bizarre to even attempt to introduce Hilton, but here I go. I'll start with the facts. He is a Pulitzer Prize winning theater critic of The New Yorker, where he writes profiles, essays. He is the author of two books, The Women and White Girls. But he's also more than that. He is a curator whose most recent show on James Baldwin, God Made My Face, was exhibited at David Swerner last year. And he is an artist. Among others, being the featured artist at the Artist Institute at Hunter College. I guess as a disclaimer, I should also say that he is also, or was, my professor. And he was very good at making you feel like you haven't read anything at all, but still making you want to have so much to say, which I think is a wonderful quality for a professor. But I think the best way to describe him was actually this line I found in Toni Morrison's eulogy for James Baldwin, where she says about Baldwin, "Your life refuses summation. It always did, and invites contemplation instead." So.
I'm exhibiting shyness on Zoom. I'm putting my head down a little bit, but I'm here. And Mary, that's so moving. Thank you for having me. I know that you've worked so hard to make this happen, and you know you're one of my great students. And I think that you know what attracts me to students is not only the quality of their work, but the quality of their spirit. And you have a lot of spirit and outgoingness towards other people. So I'm happy to be here.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you. Mm-hmm. I guess I'll describe a little bit the format of this evening.
Sure.
Hilton has selected a few fragments that we are going to show in between our conversation. We're going to use each of them to talk about Hilton's practice. And before we start, I guess I want to ask you how you put these fragments together. Are they kind of a personal canon in any way?
I think for sure that everything is really personal when it comes to those artifacts or films or books, movies that really have made a difference in your consciousness or have appealed to or given language, actually given you language to talk about the things that you didn't know that you wanted to talk about. There is this pre-existing world of culture that's marvelous because it's a sort of virtual museum that you can visit at will and stumble across the things that matter to you. So that's why I always place an importance on reading and discovering. So everything that we've chosen today, Mary, is for me when I was your age or a little bit older, they were very significant acts of creation for me, and they spoke to me because they supplied a kind of vocabulary about sensibility, gender, storytelling that I didn't know how to do. And so these were sort of, in a way, great teachers to me about how to present a spectacle or how to describe a spectacle or how to talk about things that were significant events in New York or in my cultural life. And I think that they've all had a profound influence on me and how to shape and how they've really sort of been helpful in terms of shaping me. So I wanted to share the things that were helpful, not so much to my life as a critic, more to my life as a being, really.
And that leads kind of nicely to the first fragment we're going to play, which is a fragment from The Group, the film adaptation of Mary McCarthy's novel, because it is about, you know, eight young female graduates being formed in the world, willingly or unwillingly. So before we start, do you have anything you'd like to say about that?
I love the movie a lot, and I like the book a lot too. It's kind of a little bit silly, the book, but the thing that I think is sort of more interesting about the film is the casting. And I happen to know the man who had cast it, and he said that every role was filled by the most perfect performer for it, whose life story was a little bit overlapping with the characters in some way, whether it was that they had been raised in a sort of upper class milieu or were emotionally fragile. So it's, to me, it's one of the ways in which film and performance can be sort of almost hyper-realistic emotionally for me. They can condense and become metaphors for real life.
Okay, so here we go. For those who do not know the story, it is a story about eight female graduates from a Northeastern
Depression. Yeah.
Right, here we go. I am going to share my screen.
Oh, Mary, should I say one more thing?
Oh, yes, please.
This is the, one of the group has died and they've all reconverged to say goodbye to her. And that's St. Mark's Church on St. Mark's Place, where she was married several years before. Go to where he gets, go back further. Get further, 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 further. Further, further, further. Okay, right there.
We'll start from the beginning then.
Yes, I think it's better.
Paula, you and Jim and your father, you go look with Mikey in the third car.
No, I'll hold my own phone. Helena, dear, I can't go. I have a terribly important appointment. What happened really is that I just can't take anymore. It's too shattering.
So this is Candace Bergen, and it's her first role, and she was 19.
Are you going to the cemetery?
Yes.
Do you mind if I come off?
Get in.
Incinerator. It's not like a manuscript.
I hope not.
She killed herself, of course.
Why?
She had competitiveness. I used to talk about suicide. She decided she could show me how to do it. She could do it better on the first try.
You think you'll ever succeed? Even in that?
Yeah, I never picked you for a sapphic. I put it crudely, a lesbo. Were you always that way?
Always.
You had a regular seraglio up in that tower. Were you in love with Kate?
She was lovely when I first asked her to join us. She was like a wildflower. She had a fine, strong back. Tapering waist.
Are you not answering my question?
Are you impertinent?
Just how close were you, Kate?
You ought to have asked Kay that.
You're welcome. That's a filthy lesbian trick. Spreading your slime on that dead girl. Let me out of this thing.
Yara, you going to the cemetery?
You bury her. In the group.
Thank you, Mary.
As we depart from 33, go forth. A time of economic crisis. A time that asks the woman of America to play a role in every sphere of a nation's life. In the arts, in the sciences, in industry, and in the making of our laws. And we believe, as we take up our separate roles, that it is only in achieving the highest personal fulfillment, the goal of our education, that each will make the greatest contribution to our emergent America.
Thank you, Mary.
So, we end with a sapphic.
Yes.
You also, you selected this film for the Queer Art Film Series. So,
yeah.
That makes me wonder whether you want to, do you want to say something about the queerness in the film surrounded by all these disastrous straight relationships?
Yes. What I love about the storytelling here, Mary McCarthy's very classical narrative form, within that narrative form, queerness finds itself in between, meaning it's not a specifically queer novel, but within the parameters and limitations of a classical narrative form, she is able to tell the story of queerness as a way of these women being together. And that the group itself has been formed by a queer woman who goes off to study art history, comes back from Europe with a foreign lover, and disrupts the silence around queerness in the book and in their lives, is really kind of an extraordinary thing for her to have done and to have admitted. I think I've taught in women's colleges specifically Smith College, a great experience. And I always told them at the beginning of each semester to treasure this moment because you're in the majority. And when you go out into the world, women are not in the majority. And if you're in the majority, you start to feel and think differently than not. So I treasure the book and I treasure the movie deeply for McCarthy's understanding of how power and queerness finds itself in the most kind of heteronormative academic society. It still queers it. It still queers the story. And I think she did a brilliant job in that respect. And each of the performances is just exemplary in terms of not giving us all of the information about, was it sexual? Was it emotional? Of course it was emotional. They were, all of them were lifetime partners with each other. So it's a really great book, and I recommend the movie wholeheartedly.
I think in the novel, at the end, one of them says, now Nikki is going to shame us for not being lesbians.
but you are, Blanche, you are. You know, that's sort of what's great is that they have been emotionally in love with each other. And Lakey's the only one who's given language to this, who's been aware of it. And I love her as a character. The knowingness of Candace Bergen's face is, you know, don't be stupid. Of course, we're all together.
Is there a place, physical or mental, you go to feel surrounded or in a majority?
My library. I think right behind me that I feel very connected to the writers and artists and photographers. And, you know, Jean Rhys is a wonderful writer, a great writer. And she said that she does this wonderful dialogue with herself in her book, Smile Please. And she's asking the judge of her life, she says, I just want it to be this little trickle in the great ocean of creation, of writing. And I feel the same, that I feel so ultimately blessed. It saved my life to know that I could connect to other people who were working out of isolation or loneliness or joy. It was a really great revelation to me.
And is there a way that your kind of library building has changed in recent years?
No, I'm still very badly educated, so I have no real system.
There's no hope for us.
I have joy. I sort of read one thing, and then someone mentions something in an index, and then I read that book, and I always feel underread, and I think that that's the condition of reading, and that, you know, the Benjamin essay about unpacking your library, you never feel that you're catching up.
One of the qualities about your work that really strikes me is that is this sense of freedom. You know, when I read it, I feel free, but I also feel free to write, create, think. And it makes me wonder whether there was a moment in your artistic life where you felt, I'm free.
That's a great question. I think I'm a guilty person, you know? I just walk around the world feeling guilty. And I think that when I'm working on something and it sort of, you can feel the energy shift in a piece of writing where you're not in control of it anymore. You're controlling the form, but you're not controlling, for want of a better word, your subconscious. And those are the moments that you live for, because then the pages just happen. They've just been waiting for you to show up. That's what it feels like. That you've been waiting, that your subconscious has been waiting for you to show up to display your mind.
And are there things you do to nurture that subconscious?
I think one of the more important things that you can do really is do nothing. I don't know how other writers have been feeling during the pandemic, but it took me some months because of personal issues to kind of settle into this way of being. But once I did, I started to feel that it was almost like a second chance, that a lot of the time that I had spent socializing unnecessarily, or things, that time that gets eaten up in New York, stopped. And I was able to really have that time for reflection. And so even if I'm not writing every minute or every day, I know that it's in there happening, and it's actually being nourished by rest and reading and reflection. And that feels kind of extraordinary, that we have this, as artists, we have this second chance to really look at ourselves. So it's been a mixed blessing for me.
What I've experienced in the pandemic is that, I think as an artist, you often have to protect yourself. You have to kind of build a fort around the external influences, things that want to eat up your time, your energy. And I had hoped that the pandemic would, free me from that a little bit. But as the months increase, I found that I still need to protect myself, in different ways.
Yes, I think that's a very true, because there'll always be an excuse not to work. There'll always be an excuse not to protect yourself. There's always an excuse, someone needs me or whatever. But I think of this wonderful line from Proust, and who had spent so many years going out, right? And being social. And in the end, he said that the only thing that social life gives you is indigestion. And he got to work. So I think that this is kind of our collective Proustian moment to get to work in our quiet, and to understand that social life does, in fact, and at last, give you indigestion. It's not worth it.
Global indigestion.
Yeah, exactly. Or at least for artists, yeah.
Speaking of artists, should we move on to the next fragment?
Yes.
Which I believe is topsy-turvy.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Would you like to say about that before we start?
Topsy-turvy is one of the great movies by Mike Lee about cultural appropriation. So the film is about Gilbert and Sullivan trying to make their opera the Mikado and being quote unquote inspired by Japanese culture and storytelling. But when the quote unquote real Japanese people show up, they can't stop laughing at how ridiculous the English look to them, imitating something that they don't understand. So at the end of it, there's a kind of beautiful marriage of, and it's a wonderful marriage of cultures, but also it's a wonderful, the scene that we have is a great evocation of the performer taking lines from Gilbert and Sullivan and making a monologue. So what she says is actually from one of the arias from the opera, but she makes it about her character. It's beautiful.
Okay, let's hope that this share screen is going to go better than the previous.
Mm-hmm.
Here we go. Share computer sound.
Yes, I'm indeed beautiful. Sometimes I sit and wonder, in my artless Japanese way, why it is that I am so much more attractive than anybody else in the whole world. Can this be vanity? No. Nature is lovely and rejoices in her loveliness. I am a child of nature, and take after my mother.
Thank you, Mary. I find it so moving because what she's doing as a performer is respecting the text while not pretending to be something she's not. She's dressed in this costume, but she doesn't marginalize the culture that's inspired this scene, while also not lying about her Englishness. And it is such a delicate balancing act, and no one leaves that space feeling condescended to. And I think that that's what I love about this is the truth of the performer, that one of the gifts that is so extraordinary about performers is that when they tell the truth, they tell the truth for all of us, and they also speak to all of us about ourselves. And it's just, it's rare. Believe me, I've seen a lot of plays and, you know, a lot of people don't reach those points, but when they do, it is utterly transformative of space and of your mind and heart. And so when we see something that beautifully distilled and that complicated, handled so expertly, it takes my breath away.
What I find very touching almost about the Orientalism of a certain period. And I guess with that period, I also almost mean the period before the internet probably, is that despite its obvious complexities, it's very much an act of imagination, right? There was not that much. There's a scene in this film earlier where they're creating the costumes and all they have to go on are these like little watercolor illustrations. You know, so all these artists are really imagining more than they are imitating, plagiarizing.
Exactly right. That's what, and I think that that was the genius of Mike Lee as the director, was he wanted to make a film, and you know, as you know, he improvises a great deal and the actors make the script in rehearsal. And I think that all of them were aware of the fine line that they were walking. And there was something profound about their sensitivity to what's going on, and also the fact that they are cultural appropriators. And what does that mean? Does it grow out of, is that something that grows out of love? Why wouldn't they have Japanese performers? All of that stuff, 19th century junk that was there, they were able to make it real and present to a present day audience, because it's something that we still do, whether it's Elvis Presley and Big Mama Thornton or any number of things that are American, for instance, or British, really began in another culture entirely.
And you recently, I have to mention, I forgot to mention this in your introduction, but you recently switched the roles, swapped roles, and wrote a play rather than being the observer of it.
Yes, it was a great experience because it was about the performance artist Cheryl Sutton, who had been Robert Wilson's great muse in the 70s. She is a Black woman from New Orleans, and also one of the very, very few women, people of color working in the New York avant-garde in the 70s. And so I did this piece really based for Okwi and Helga Davis, who performed it, and it was directed by Okwi's husband, Peter Bjorn, and it was a great evening in North Carolina. And hopefully one day it will come back. But I loved the experience of feeling vulnerable to the words and not being protected by critical self, but by artist self. And it was cringy and wonderful, and you feel very exposed. And I think that's very good for any writer to feel in a public space. because we have the safety of distance. But I think that we need to put ourselves out there and understand how performers feel or visual artists feel when they exhibit themselves or the work.
So making theater and observing or criticizing it does not involve the same muscles?
No, it doesn't, because you're observing and giving language to something that has been, that pre-exists through other people. And when you are the artist or the maker, you're presenting a world of your own imagination.
And what is your, how would you describe your relationship to performers? Because, you know, when you were young, you thought you were going to become one.
I think yes, but I think that I never had the thing that all performers have, which is a real desire to get out there and do it. I didn't really have that feeling. I had more of the feeling of, wow, that's amazing that you can do that. I liked improvising. It was the most fun that I ever had on stage. And I had a great friend named Catherine Joyce, and we were kind of the Nichols and May of this high school, because we were very fast storytellers, and I liked that. But that was really just an example of writing, really. If you're improvising, you're making a story up. So I thought, why beleaguer people by having me up on stage when I can just write this, you know? It felt much more interesting for me to be the storyteller as opposed to the performer telling the story.
It's interesting that you say that, because when I read your writing on performers, whether it's in your profiles or your criticism, mm-hmm. there's this moment where you kind of start to inhabit them and kind of enter from within and then mm-hmm. observe them from the inside. That is almost a performative gesture.
That's very clever of you, Mary. You get an A in this class.
I was hoping that you would say that.
But I feel that that's actually true, that one of the things that interests me about them is how do you get out there to tell that story? What's in you that gives you the physicality and the presence of mind? It never ceases to interest me. Once when I was writing about Jane Fonda, for instance, I asked her what it was like to, she was talking about Roger Vadim, her first husband, and she said, oh, it's so heady, you know, he's in that other room typing something for you and he's thinking about you. That's a performer. The writer is like, oh shit, like how do I make a story? And the performer's like, they're thinking about me. It's a different, it's a hair's difference, but it's a profound difference. So, you know, I think that often we're very attracted to each other. Arthur Miller and Marilyn Monroe, for instance, or I have a friend who's married to an actor. So it's the difference between physicalizing words and not.
Right.
You know, that's a kind of marriage. You know?
Speaking of words, Toni Morrison.
Oh, yes. lovely little clip.
Does it need any introduction?
She was a young woman working at Random House as an editor, full-time, single mother, two boys, and she started writing out of loneliness. She had been, she'll tell you the story herself, but it's always so moving to me what we can do and how art really claims us out of a kind of loneliness, I think, and how we can make things based on that loneliness and sense of humor and love.
Okay, here we go.
Mm-hmm. I was in a writer's group when I was in Washington. The nice thing, I like to be without bringing something you'd written, something new. So one afternoon, I sat down on the couch. My little boy was less than a year, and he was, you know, pulling rings and doing whatever. And I was writing like this on a legal pad. And he would, you know, go away and crawl back and so on. And I got terribly interested in what I was doing. Got really good to figure out which word came before the next and what was explosive and so on. But just, you know, hurriedly writing it for that evening's meeting. And while I was in the middle of an extremely important sentence, he spit up. He threw up all over my paper.
And the reason I love it is because it's real life, you know? She said, I got terribly interested in what I did, and he threw up on the tape. So it's just a wonderful evocation of the reality of making work. It's just a wonderful story.
And you met her several times.
Yes, she was a real... I think one of the underappreciated things about Toni was how very attractive she was as a woman. She was just super attractive. You know, she was in her body in a way, and it was also her ability to laugh and at the absurdity of things that was also super attractive. And she was just also really beautiful. So she was a person that you would want to spend time with because of all the levels of attractiveness available to you in her person, you know. Not to mention being a genius and all of that stuff, but just as a being on the planet, she was just an enormously attractive human being.
You profiled her, and was it 2003?
Yes.
And I thought it was quite brave how at some point in the profile, you kind of retract an earlier opinion that you had written of her work.
Yes.
Would you like to talk about that and how maybe...
Yes. I think that I was a very young writer, and I wrote something critical about her. And I realized it was a way of claiming my own space. And so I went up to Nyack to visit her. And went to her house, and she drove me to a restaurant. And it was one of those big sort of... restaurants on the Hudson River that are sort of empty a lot, and somehow they managed to make a living. I never know how. And she said, I didn't like what you wrote about me in X thing. And I swear to you, Mary, I turned around. I didn't know who she was talking to. I was such a different person by then. And I said, I'm sorry, who? I said, I swear to you, God, Toni, I didn't know who you were talking about. And she said, I can see that. And it all went away. And we became friends. So she was not only a forgiving person, she could be bigger than you and understand that you were a young person. And that she was, that she held this enormous importance. And that sometimes you have to smudge the idol a little bit before you completely succumb to their greatness, you know?
How do you, I think you once said that artists grow up in public, right? You know,
yeah.
How do you feel about growing up in public? Very conflicted.
I think that goes, that dovetails with your statement earlier about learning to protect yourself. And I think that one of the things that you learn to do is to protect yourself from the complications of being recognizable or public in some way. So that's one way that you learn. And the other way is that you write things that are mistakes, like my thing about Toni, or you write things that, or you curate things that don't quite work, or you go, you have an opinion that's not really the majority status quo opinion. And these are all things that teach you and give you your voice. You can't have your voice without making mistakes.
There was something you wrote about her when you were interviewing her for the New Yorker Festival in 2015. In your introduction, you said, who was that black man invisible to? Not to her. He was her brother, her father, her friend. Toni Morrison, through virtue of her work, has become the unqualified, authoritative voice when it comes to describing a world that makes and unmakes all those brothers, fathers, and friends.
Oh, I thought that was very touching.
Who's
that guy who wrote that?
You've grown up?
I've grown up more, but I love that I was able to celebrate her in that way. And I never felt that she was, if she cared about you, you always got the sense that she was telling you the truth about something. And if you had written something that she didn't like, she just didn't mention it. I thought that was so, that was so grown up from someone who was an editor and a teacher, and she knew how much the spirit can take of being seen and being criticized.
So what was it about the Black American male that you learned from her?
That we had a story, that we had a voice that was not one story. It wasn't Ralph Ellison's Invisible Man. It was very complex and whole and fractured like anybody else. And that the story needed, the story is plural, because it's not monolithic, needs to be told. And it also gives me permission to tell mine. I think that if you grow up in a society where your queerness is reviled or criticized, you learn how to save yourself by not speaking. And it's taken me a long time to get to the point of not speaking. It's the place where I feel freest in the world to say who I am. I think that I'm a very well brought up child. And so there's a lot of things that I've learned that prohibit me from giving you my opinion at dinner or, over drinks, but I can do it on the page because that's mine. It's not anyone else's.
I feel like speaking on the page, if you truly want to speak, what you do is that your language has such a specificity, the one word cannot be the other, and that is the way to arrive at the truth.
Yes, it's the truth of that moment of writing. It may change in a year, or, it's changed for me all the time. I don't remember a lot of what I've done because I want to keep moving forward. And no human being is their own retrospective. That's up to an editor or a museum. I think that you never arrive at the truth. It's something that you're struggling with and for all the time.
So let's move on to the next fragment, Agon.
Oh, yes.
Is there anything you would like to say about that?
This is a piece that George Balanchine made in 1955, I believe. And it was made on Arthur Mitchell, who was the first Black male dancer with the New York City Ballet, and Diana Adams. And the two artists in this rendition is the incredible Heather Watts, who to me was one of the most intelligent dancers. You could just sort of feel her brain waves. And the Mel Tomlinson, who passed away recently, who became, I believe, a preacher. It was such a shock to see miscegenation on stage at the New York City Ballet when I was a kid in 19... And I never got over the power of what Balanchine was trying to do, which is to talk about bodies in New York and competition. And Agon is a Greek word for competition, and he's using the form of these competitions to talk about dance itself. But I always felt he was also talking about New York. And the music is Stravinsky, by the way. What an amazing thing, isn't it?
Yeah, it strikes me that precisely because the video is of such a fuzzy quality, it actually makes the movements more clearly geometrical.
Exactly, that you're able to see the architecture of the piece and how his great genius was to make it seem, even in the architecture, that the body was doing what was natural to itself and to ballet, for ballet. And I started writing criticism because I was going to dance a lot with a friend, and I was 20, and I started to write. I loved a writer named Edwin Denby, who's a great critic, dance critic, and a poet. And I wanted to write like that, which was to sort of tell stories about the event of the dancing. So his review, I recommend to everyone, is called Three Sides of Agon. And he mentions race in one sentence. And he says, Mr. Mitchell, who is Black, who is Negro, that was the days, so 1955. Mr. Mitchell, who is Negro, and Miss Adams, who is white, appear, blah, 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 whatever he says. The fact that they are different is interesting. Sorry, that's my laundry, period. It sort of doesn't, he doesn't make a case for or against. He's talking about what our eye sees and what we feel in the theater. And so it has always been a kind of benchmark for me, that piece in particular, about how to write about race. That to be interesting is not necessary, to be ideological is not necessarily to be interesting. That you have to find the ways in which our differences are human and humane. And that's a much more explosive story. It's sort of like the Mary McCarthy, right? The lesbianism isn't the overriding narrative of the novel, but it actually becomes more powerful because it finds its way, it finds a way to be queer in a kind of, you know, fairly standard book. So.
So would you say that that could be a model for how to talk about race today still?
I wouldn't venture to say how someone should address those issues. I say for myself, it's a kind of model because of the form is so beautiful. And yet, whoa, something's happening in there, you know?
I mean, one thing that, you know, the piece came from the civil rights era and came from a very specific era, which makes me wonder, today I saw the news, as you probably saw, that the Met Opera is canceling its entire season. What do you think this era's performances are going to be like?
Oh my God, my heart has been bleeding for everyone who performs. I actually don't know how to help them because their livelihood and emotional currency is based on people being together to see them. So I'm hoping, but then you think about all the people who work on concession stands or the ticket takers, or it's a disaster for a whole population. And a lot of people I know on public assistance who live in Times Square, who depend on these jobs for extra income. There is no extra income, there is no income. And there's no ability to see these people, to see artists develop for a whole year. It's really kind of astonishing. It's very, very disturbing.
Do you think there will be a new model that comes out of all of this?
I'm hoping that it's a model, if there is a new model, I'm just hoping that it's sustaining.
So as we arrive kind of at the end of this hour, I would really much like to bring up Baldwin still.
Yes, please.
Even though we don't have a fragment to link to it. You curated the show last year, and mm-hmm. You also wrote a piece on him in The New Yorker, mm-hmm. where you talked about your uneasy identification with him.
Yeah. I think a lot of people have claimed him unfairly. And I think that he was himself. And I think that's a lot for someone to bear. I think identification is a lot for someone to bear. And I think that we shouldn't do that to him. We're just learning about him still. And he was a person who needed, who should have had more care in his life. And I think that if we can help him still by not saying we are like, or using him the form of some of his essays or whatever, we're helping him to breathe a little bit better and to have space in our hearts and minds instead of being co-opted and imitated. So that's why it's uneasy, and I think it should be uneasy.
Right. You talked about how the show, you tried to give Baldwin back to himself.
Yes.
How did you go about that?
It was through, again, this question of context and ideology. It was giving him a contextual reason, but not an ideological reason to be. So I wanted him to have a context for his film work that he always loved to do and his artwork. And I wanted him to have those moments of creation and artistry and to welcome the artists who had indirectly really spoken of him and about him. And so I feel that that was a great gift to me, let alone the other people, this idea of talismans and fragments of a body that we shouldn't feed on. We should feast on what he's left as an artist and leave the body alone to grow and prosper.
It reminds me of something you wrote in the book accompanying your Addis Neal exhibition, also at David's Werner. Mm-hmm. You wrote about the essay. You said, the essay is not about the empirical I, but about the collective, all the voices that made your I. And yeah, it makes me feel like that could be a way to describe how you make exhibitions as well. Yes,
exactly, that it's, we have the discipline of form, right? That's the hard part, and editing. You're not putting everything in by anybody. So you have this forum to speak, and it's about distilling information and imparting information. And your job is to be as clear as possible. The way that Balanchine was deeply clear in his dance, we have to be clear as curators and writers about intention. And while leaving, I think, leaving mystery intact. We don't know, I don't have all the answers at all about what the show meant or what it was supposed to be, but I did have some beginnings, and it was to give him his body back, for sure.
Brian, do we still have time?
Should we take questions or?
Two questions?
I think it's a great time to move on to questions.
Good.
Okay, so I will open the chat. Anyone who has a question? Oh, I should mention that I am going to transform the transcript of this conversation into a written interview as part of the Miscellaneous Files series that I published. So anyone who asks a question, if you do not feel comfortable about me potentially using that question in the written interview, please let me know. But I hope that that has not dissuaded you of asking questions. Mm-hmm. In the meanwhile, my rabbit is eating all the books here.
So as I mentioned at the beginning, for any questions, I think it's best to type them into the chat to everyone.
Brian?
Hi.
Hey, Brian. Can I speak?
Yes.
You are?
Yeah, because, yeah, I'm taking that as a task to, like, speak and not be afraid to speak. So Hilton, it was some years ago on, like, a very tired year in, like, my father's house in Lagos, Nigeria, that I first encountered your writing. And it was the piece on Prince. And I remember being very struck by it and struck by all of the things that it was doing.
Thank you.
To pick just one of the things, it gave me permission. And that could mean many things, but yeah, for now, that's one word to encapsulate, like, the feeling that I had that time. And I remember, like, scouring, like, everywhere for, like, interviews. Because it's just a very great way to kind of understand, like, how a person thinks after encountering, like, the form of a person's mind on the page. I can't express how wonderful, like, it has been to hear you speak. Now that I've left Lagos and I'm here in New York, it's funny the way life happens. Thank you. I do have a question about what you mentioned about the truth of performance.
Yes.
And because of the way I'm so intimate, like, with language, I also, in a way, consider, like, writing a form of performance on the page.
Yes.
About truth, how do you think one reaches this truth, right? Is it true the personal? Is it true, like, the universal? Or is it, like, a weird hybrid of both?
I think it's a hybrid. And I think that if you're going to be writing your own material to perform, that you know when you're faking it, you know, when you're telling a part of the story that's not true or real, we'll feel that. Because you're the storyteller and you're the one who's in control of taking us someplace through your storytelling. So I think that if it's true on the page, it's going to be true in your body. And one of the things that's really very important to understand is that we can feel what you feel if you're telling the truth. So when Shirley Henderson in Topsy Turvy, she took a piece of a song and made a little monologue, right? But it was true about herself interest, her regard for herself as a performer. We felt that. It was thrilling. And it's sort of like when you were little and if you told a fib to your mother or your father, they just knew when it was not true what you were saying. The audience can feel that too. So I think that the best thing is to not lie to yourself, and then it becomes a universal story. If you're telling the truth to yourself, we'll feel that for sure.
There are a few questions coming in through the chat. Shall I pick one?
Yeah, I think we have time for two more.
Two more, okay, I see two here. Do you have, from Cheryl McCoy?
Thank you, I'm sorry, I didn't thank the young woman for her question earlier. What's your name? She's in Kit Kat. Your name, dear?
My name is Olakitan.
Olakitan, thank you for your beautiful question. Good luck with your work.
Thank you.
Yes.
So we have two questions here. One is, do you have any tips for writing about social justice without coming off as performative? This is from Cheryl McCourty.
Cheryl, I think that it holds true from what I just said to the young woman about telling the truth, that if you tell the truth about your experience, nobody can be mad at you because it's true and it resonates as individual. I think that that's what can get lost during terrible times, is that people start speaking as if they're speaking for a group of people as opposed to themselves. And if you speak for yourself, the group will follow. The group will find you. But speak as yourself and for yourself, and communicate. You know, writing is a form of communication, and we want to know what you feel and think. It's such a, we're so lucky that we are able to have individual responses to things.
Next question is about performance in writing. From Jancy Creaney. I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing your names. Hilton, do you feel a shift when writing that resembles performance, maybe affecting a sudden change in cadence, tone, rhythm?
Yes, that can happen largely based on, if I'm writing on something about memory, and I remember something that happened, or I can actually have a revelation talking to a family member about something I don't remember very clearly. They can illuminate that, and it's a physical charge that happens, because I know then that the truth will be even more, because it's verifiable, it resonates more deeply. I do feel that when I watch performers that where they tell the truth, and it's really kind of an amazing feeling. It's like meeting someone that you are going to be in love with, and you know it's going to happen. And they shake you out of your everydayness, you know. Yeah.
Was that the last? Should we do one last question or
one more? One last one.
One last question, from Aladdin Ula.
Mm-hmm.
Hilton, if you write a play, a memoir, etc., there are gatekeepers that make decisions on your work. How do you navigate between being authentic and not surrendering to a Hollywood shuffle kind of work? For example, how do you avoid the Muslim is the boogeyman kind of plays, as well as making plays that make white subscription-based audiences comfortable?
I think that there are, in contemporary theater, there are a number of people who write according to the specifications of what they feel the audience wants, what a hip audience wants. But the great playwright Lillian Hellman once said, "I can't cut my conscience to fit this year's fashions." And the way that I navigate it is to be as clear as I can be in the work, but also understand that they have a job to do, editors and dramaturgs, and have a job to do, but that doesn't necessarily mean that it's my job too. So it becomes a conversation. If you can make it a conversation about your goals and how much help you, we all need to make work. It can make the process a little gentler. Thank you, Mary.
Thank you, Hilton. Thank you. And thank you, everyone, for...
No, you've been great. Thanks.
Thank you both, guys. Hey, maybe to everyone at home, I can ask you to actually unmute, and maybe we can give them some actual real applause.
Thank you, Ryan. Aww. Thanks, guys. It's been a great experience.